It used to be that we always had a handy pen. Now we have a handy mask everywhere. We're just waiting for our online audience to join.
Welcome to the 29th anniversary of the TT 100 Business Innovation Awards program. Please also join us on Twitter using hashtag TT100 2020. You are about to be introduced to organizations who have excelled in demonstrating their excellence in the management of technology, the management of innovation, the management of people, systemic thinking, and sustainable performance. Creating a transdisciplinary reality. The Millau Viaduct in southern France serves as a great example of transdisciplinary engagement and the value such co-created reality can bring to society. The rural town of Millau have been confronted with high levels of traffic congestion during the summer months since the 1980s, caused at large by increasing numbers of tourists traveling between France and Spain. For many years, the community reflected on how they could probe the problem in an attempt to design and develop a lasting solution for local citizens, migrating tourists, as well as nature, respecting the existing rich and biodiverse environment of the Tarn Valley. Being part of the Grands Gorges Regional Natural Park, a lot of time was spent on understanding the biodiversity of the area. Over time, four potential solutions were examined. The impact on both the people and the natural environment took prominence and were abandoned because of four reasons. The anticipated negative impact on the water level of the Tarn River. The negative impact on the surrounding geological structures. The interference with the seasonal movement of migrating birds and the negative economic impact on the community in and around the town of Millau. Today, this transdisciplinary reality towers 336.4 meters above the clouds, built at a slight curve and a slight incline to accommodate the human response to height, respecting the rich biodiversity of the environment, allowing the Millau community to continue to be financially sustainable even though the tourist traffic has been redirected away from the town. This lesson in creating a transdisciplinary reality reminds us as managerial leaders that we need to consider the value of co-creating transdisciplinary realities in service of society.
Good evening, everyone. The Commissioner of SARS, Professor Edward Kizveta, who's joined us online from Cape Town, the Director General of the Department of Science and Innovation, Dr. Phil Majuaro, who sits here in the front, the Deputy Director General, also of the Department of Science and Innovation, Dr. Mbuneni Muefe. Wonderful to see you again. It was also fantastic to see you at your graduation. So nice to see you this twice in a month. He got his PhD recently from DaVinci. And then the deputy director of strategic partnerships is also here, which is Toto Machadiso. We welcome you and thank you for being here. Professor Ben Anderson, the director of the TT 100 Awards Program. All protocols observed, ladies and gentlemen. The theme, as you would have hopefully seen, of the 2020 TT 100 Business Innovation Awards Program is creating a transdisciplinary reality. You might wonder why we selected this viaduct to explain something like creating a transdisciplinary reality. And I hope that the video contextualized it. But I want to challenge your minds a little bit by saying that transdisciplinarity holds that there are multiple realities. And I think that this is really critical to understand that reality exists at multiple levels and across various ecosystems. As human beings, I find that we often isolate subsystems. So what we may do is we look at one aspect, but not at another. And from an ecosystemic perspective, it is really critical that we engage with all aspects. And that would be from your own interpersonal and your own self-reflective perspective, all the way around to what impacts you throughout. So I always say things like, when probing a problem, you deal with a given context, absolutely. But what is critical, as an example, could be the current COVID-19 pandemic. When you reflect inwardly, you should reflect outwardly as well. So we cannot only look what is happening in society, but or what is looking at us as an individual, but what is happening across the microcosm of the entire ecosystem. That is why we focus on things like the micro, the meso, the exo, and the macro subsystems. And the reason that we gave you this context of and utilized the Malawi Viaduct Bridge as a contextual and real-world example of co-creating transdisciplinary engagements and realities, because it actually affords us the opportunity for lasting solutions. And I think it is critical to respect all of our ecosystems that make up our own society and the world at large. As we move into the fifth industrial revolution, we often speak about the symbiotic dance between technology and humanity. And every one of you sitting here this evening who has taken the time to compete in these business awards really understands what that takes, because it is bridging people and technology. But more importantly, I want to challenge all of us that we do not only look at those two aspects, but we look at the entire ecosystem that is at play in this dance. And we never forget the lenses that we should see the world through, because it becomes critical when we look at things like tradition and culture versus embracing modernity. We should never lose one for the other, or forsake one for the other. Just like you should never forsake yourself as an individual for the world out there, but you should inwardly give back to the world. So it is really critical as managerial leaders that we remind ourselves constantly to consider this value of co-creating transdisciplinary realities across the ecosystems in service of both self and society. It is my absolute honor and pleasure to officially welcome you this evening. We've got Professor Edward Kizveta, the Commissioner of the South African Revenue Services. He's logging online to join us from Cape Town.
The TT 100 Business Innovation Awards program proudly presents Professor Edward Kizveta, Commissioner of the South African Revenue Services.
Prof, thank you so much for joining us, and we look forward to engaging with you this evening.
Thank you, and what a pleasure it is to take technology available that allows to be virtually present. Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. I also acknowledge the presence of the dignitaries. You've already been welcomed, but especially to my colleague and friend, Dr. Phil Mdjwaha, who is our guest speaker this evening, and I can tell you, also the recent award winner of the Top Director General Award within the Civil and Public Service. So really a great honor to have him along with his colleagues tonight. And of course also our host and CEO, Professor Ben Anderson. A special acknowledgement to the Institute institution's missions actually make an event such as this even impossible. Without entries, we cannot have awards, and without awards, we cannot have an event. So all in honor of you. The theme this year, which as you heard, is transdisciplinary innovation. This theme is specifically relevant when innovation serves a social purpose. Transdisciplinarity is often not well understood. Institutions of learning are traditionally organized along disciplinary lines into faculties. Academic qualifications, when then awarded, follows the same. So you are awarded a degree in science, a degree in engineering, a degree in commerce or in arts. Beyond narrow specialization is recognized also at advanced degrees. You go even narrower than your first degree. Professional occupations then naturally follow this for a large part. And we end up in life as lawyers, accountants, and physicians. The above depiction is useful when the problem at hand is a narrow technical one. I would not want a broad generalist to perform highly specialized brain surgery on one of my loved ones, or to defend me in court, or to prepare and sign off important financial statements on which I may base an investment decision. So I acknowledge the role of functional specialists. The reality, though, is that most social challenges do not neatly present itself as narrow functional problems. Social problems are complex, poorly defined. Hardly ever should the solution respond simply to a narrow functional perspective. Solving complex social problems has multidimensional facets that has to be addressed. COVID-19, as we heard, is a point. If we had to define it as a narrow health problem and focus only on preventing the transmission, then people would die of hunger. If one solved it as an economic problem and opened the economy, that would mean that people would die of the virus. Many would be infected and succumb to the coronavirus. So as we speak, we can quantify the number of cases affected. We can also, the economy is likely to contract by 7.8%. And these are easy things to measure. But just because you can measure something doesn't mean it matters. Or if it cannot be measured, that it does not matter. We still cannot tell you, therefore, what the psychosocial devastation will ultimately be left in its wake when the virus is finally done with us. We are still unclear exactly what the new normal will finally look like. Because these things are harder to measure, but they are integral to the complex social phenomena that the coronavirus has called us to respond to. Returning therefore to transdisciplinary innovation, I am clear that transdisciplinarity is not the superficial coordination of or interaction between multiple disciplines to solve a functional problem. It is more likely about framing a complex social problem, recognizing its multidimensional facets, and then a synthesis across a number of functional or knowledge disciplines that creates a new field of practice which is transdisciplinary. My friend Professor Anderson would refer to it as the dance between the algorithm and the andro-rhythm, or as I would call it, the interplay between, which for example may be data-driven machine learning algorithms, on the one hand, and on the other hand, our essential humanity, along with the complexity of emotionally, intellectually, and vision-inspired learning. In the end, machines can use algorithms to solve clearly defined problems, but no human curiosity and imagination can be left out, because that is where the power and the energy comes, the creative essence that has the power to pose the powerful questions that can transform our lives. And once the correct problems have been posed, most machines can fix it. In other words, we're looking for complex social problems that will have inordinate social impact. In other words, the pursuit of true social purpose-driven innovation. So as we welcome you to enjoy the evening and appreciate the fruits of hours of unbounded human ingenuity, inspired by innovation, countless hours of loving labor, I ask you to reflect on the following. How do we innovate in a way that serves the noblest of social purposes, so that the world we bequeath to the next generation is a fundamentally different and fundamentally better world than the one we have inherited? Welcome to this evening. Enjoy it with us. I will stay online to enjoy it from all the way from Cape Town. Thank you, Program Director. I wish you and Professor Anderson and all those present a most wonderful evening.
Thank you so much, Prof. Kizveta. He's reminded me that I didn't introduce myself. So my name is Dr. Marla Koonin, and I am your program director this evening. But I think I always love hearing Prof. Kizveta speak, because I think one of the things that for me is critical, he spoke about the dance between the algorithm and the andorhythm that Prof. Anderson speaks of, and the dance between technology and the human interface. But I think that question you posed, Prof, around how do we innovate to support noble endeavors is really something for me that is critical. In order to truly, when you look at that theme that we've put together about the viaducts, a big part about that was about sustainability. And it's about asking ourselves, what does it actually mean to be authentically sustainable? And I think those are critical aspects we have to look at. If you look when they constructed that, it was about looking at biodiversity and all aspects. And I think from our perspective, we really have to be focused when looking at innovation on how we will actually transform society. The other aspect about the psychosocial aspects and the implications of COVID, Prof. Kizveta, I couldn't agree with you more. I think we're going to be seeing the aftermath and the impact of that. But what it has shown every single one of us is how important this concept of co-creation is. Because when we were taken out of our comfort zones and we were told we couldn't co-create with people anymore, we could only meet with people online, we couldn't have social interactions, you saw a lot of the psychosocial collapse, which shows us that we are beings that require this. So co-creating is a critical aspect. I always speak about the concept of Ubuntu, because I really believe I am because we are. So I challenge you to co-create in the way of an African, Ubuntu, and to really bring that spirit into everything that we do. The other thing is solving social problems, Prof, that you raised. I think your aspects that you always speak to about being a servant leader come in here as well. Because if we are truly going to be solving social problems, we as managerial leaders have to be servant leaders. We have to be the people that aid the change and guide the change, but are also serving the people on a continual basis. And so it is no surprise to me, Dr. Majora, that you are the top Director General Award nominee and winner, because you certainly epitomize this in every way. And you will see that as the evening unfolds and the contribution that his department has made to the TT100 Awards program. Thanks, Prof. Kizveta, and thank you for staying online. It is now indeed my honor to call on the chairperson for the TT100 adjudicators for 2020, Dr. Dzingai Kasamba, to come to the front to share some insights about the 2020 adjudication process. This is a critical part of ensuring these awards have the integrity that is required. Dr. Kasamba, please do come forward.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Good evening.
Is it a bit?
Thanks, bro. Thank you very much. Professor Kizveta, Dr. Mzwara, Professor Anderson, our program director, Dr. Mala, all dignitaries invited here. I welcome you this evening. 2020 has been a year which is different from many years that have passed and many years that shall come. You all totally agree with me that it is defined by one clear paradox: the period before the COVID-19 and the new normal that we are all living in. I normally used to use an analogy where I was saying nobody was responsible for this pandemic and nobody should be held accountable for errors and mistakes done as we try to adjust. And I normally say it's like you are told to jump over the cliff and you build the parachute as you jump. When myself and Victor were working on the TT100 awards, we were sort of confused initially because we were used to the brick and mortar setup that we have done over the past 13 years since 1991. But here we are this evening. It's a wonderful evening and it has happened. I'm going to share with you the process that we went through to come up with this remarkable evening. And I'd like to thank all the adjudicators, all the participants for the hard work, the effort, and the dedication they've put. Since 1991, the TT100 has been focused on our TIPS framework, where we focus on the management of technology, management of innovation, management of people, and management of system. Our aim has been and still remain to help companies to use these aspects as a bedrock upon which businesses are built. And we've got a lot of case studies of companies that started the TT100 as small companies. They graduated to become medium companies. Some of them are now large companies. In 2019, we had 45 participants. And this year, regardless of how difficult it was, we had a very good number of 35 participants. And it has been a very challenging and difficult year. So we collected the data, which was validated by our partner PwC to authenticate and ensure that the results are as authentic as possible. So the adjudication process ran as follows. Initially, we called for entries. I shall share the numbers with you later after I've run through the process. And we entered into the Kanban registration process. And not any Kanban could just join. We had to do some stringent and rigorous vetting. From there, we ran our online questionnaires. Then we did physical adjudication, but most of them we ran them online. And after the collection of the data, we did our rigorous analysis. And this led us now to the award section, and it culminated into this remarkable day. So we had 204 interested participants in total, and we had a total of 112 categories on the finalists. And from there, we picked up 28 category of winners. This was a gruesome process, and it really required some dedicated hands. So we had 15 adjudicators to carry out that task. And the total number of adjudicated subcategories on the emerging companies, we had 60. On the small enterprises, we had 30. And we had 24 large companies and 24 medium enterprises. In total, we had 66% total participants coming out of the emerging and small enterprises, which is an encouraging number for me because this is the incubation hub where the blue chip companies and the baobabs are going to emerge. So if out of these 66%, you can push them to become maybe 30% or 40% of them to be large-scale enterprises, the economy of South Africa will be so robust and it will continue to move on. So we had 8 categories in total, and 17% were large, 17% medium-scale enterprises, 22% were small, and 44% emerging. And again, it's quite encouraging that it will be very easy for this 44% of the emerging organizations to slip onto the large-scale enterprises, which is good for our economy. So in terms of the 156 categories across the broad spectrum, we had categories within the management of technology, management of innovation, management of people, management of systems. Then we had another category called sustainability. Then the Director General's Award for emerging and small scale enterprises. And we really appreciate the support that we have received from the Director General's office. It has been very overwhelming. Then we've got the Minister's Award, that's another category. And lastly, we have the Innovation Concept Award. Lastly, 63% of the category awards were finalists, and 37% were winners. Ladies and gentlemen, it's an honor and a privilege today to be standing before companies which managed to sweat it out and achieve winning positions within different categories. I thank you for all the support and enjoy the evening.
Everything is a new normal, so I have to sanitize this for you, Dr. Majwara, later, and then I must move it out the way and not touch it. Okay. Thank you so much, Dr. Kasamba. I want to challenge you on one thing. When you speak about the new normal, Prof. Anderson and myself are challenging people about this concept of the new normal, because one of the things that we're speaking to is believing that something like a pandemic is absolutely unexpected and absolutely unpredictable. But what we hope is that those of you that have shown us here this evening, that if you manage your technology, your innovation, your people, and your systems in a systemic way, and you consider the ecosystemic, co-creative, transdisciplinary realities that are out there in the world, but truly, what I really mean by that is, if you actually take into account the various subsystems that are at continual play around us, and we take into account that they intersect and they dissect at all times, and you take that with a systemic perspective, we really believe that whatever comes your way, you will be able to deal with. And I think all of you sitting here today have shown us that you have been able to bounce through a crisis and through a pandemic by being here this evening, and you, every single one of you, have given us hope, because it shows us that we have hope. And I applaud every one of you sitting here tonight. I now call on Pandulu Lichani, who is our program manager for TT100, to hand over a small gift of appreciation to 9 of our 15 adjudicators. The other adjudicators have joined us online, so they will virtually be getting their books, and then we will deliver it to them. But Pandulu, we ask you to please hand this over. As you will see, our lovely assistants are wearing gloves, so please note, and sanitizing. So if your book's a little bit sticky, that is why. Okay, I think these are decisions you have to make, so no. But what you are doing is taking a photo. So if I could ask you, Victor, you need to co-create here, you need to take a photo. So if you stand up there and they go up. You see, I'm coordinated. Prof Ben is cooperative and Victor's collaborative. Thank you. You know, sanitizer does last for a certain amount of time. I think few people understand the personal sacrifice that our adjudicators make, their true commitment to wanting to make this process work. So we thank each and every one of you for your commitment to this process. I always say that knowledge generation and the insights that you provide are something that is really a contribution to generating knowledge. So thank you, Mark, on that one.
I'm calling Dr. Mta.
Thank you, Dr. Minta.
I'm calling Dr. Petrus.
I think it's really important that we always acknowledge the things that a lot of the winners have always said, that the contributions the adjudicators continually make to the process and how it's actually improved organizations. And I see a previous winner over here from Access, Terrell, who has acknowledged that as well, that it is something that is a huge contribution. So the challenging thing about a small function is you can see when somebody is having a conversation in the front, Victor. I certainly enjoyed your video, so, and the aspects of the contributions that all our adjudicators make. We always get feedback from all adjudicators throughout the process, and I always enjoy listening to what each of them has to say about all the organizations that participate. So that's always fantastic. Thanks, Pendulu. Well, ladies and gentlemen, it gives me great pleasure to take this opportunity to actually give you some feedback on our two internships and one learnership program, which would not have been possible without the department that we've already spoken to, and that is the Department of Science and Innovation, Dr. Majwara and his team, because we were able to take in 45 students for the 2021 program on their generous donation to be able to get students to truly be empowered. And I'd like to speak to you a little bit about how we've separated these 45 students. So 15 of these students are currently engaged on the How to Innovate Learnership. They're currently completing a higher certificate in the Management of Technology and Innovation. These students, once they've completed their higher certificate, will also do a 10-month work experience, and I'm sure you will agree that getting that actual work experience is critical to the process, especially with students that come from either unemployed backgrounds. Some of them have had minimal employment, but all of them have got very limited experiences. And in terms of this, what is really amazing is after this, they will complete an integrated business simulation program. This is critical for us to ensure that they take the action learning that they've learned in the organization, and they're able to take the theoretical as well as the practical application of learning about the management of technology, innovation, and people, and they can combine this into some kind of integrated business simulation. We then believe that these 15 students will certainly be able to make an impact in society and also support their families, their communities, and go back and serve the nation. The 30 students that are remaining are separated into two groups of internships. The first internship is the Life Skills and Innovation Management Program. This is developing unemployed youths, and it's giving them life skills capabilities. So we've looked at aspects, for example, things like critical thinking, problem probing, decision making, solution creation, writing, business ethics, business communication. I'm sure each and every one of you in the business sector will agree with me that these are critical life business skills to give people. So this is our one internship program. The students that are participating in the second internship program, which is also 15 students, they are on the innovation management program. This has taken a slightly different angle, and what this is specifically looking at is aspects such as entrepreneurship. It's looking at financial accounting, numeracy, innovation management, and all those aspects that we would look at for the management of technology, innovation, and people and systems. So it takes all of that into account. And we truly do believe that these students are getting an enriching experience. The late Nelson Rolihlahla Mandela reminded us that education is the most powerful weapon you can choose to truly change the world. And we believe that these students have been afforded the opportunity to live this dream. And we would not be here with these 45 students if it wasn't for the Department of Science and Innovation for your funding. You are furthering the cause of the Honorable Nelson Mandela, but over and above that, you're in absolute alignment with the National Development Plan, recognizing that education truly is the cornerstone of society, upon which a nation can truly provide opportunities for those important and critical aspects like social mobility, equity, social justice, and our democracy depends on this. And we thank you for contributing in this manner. So without further ado, TT100 is not only proud to be associated with the DSI and want to once again express our absolute appreciation, not just for these 45 students, but the contribution you have made over years and years and years. That shows true sustainability. And it is my absolute pleasure to introduce to you our keynote speaker, not only the Director General for the Department of Science and Innovation, but the top Director General in our country, Dr. Phil Mojwara. Sorry, I was supposed to move.
So I have to acknowledge the program director, but I also like to acknowledge Ed, that's how we call him in the workplace, because he's now part of us as civil servants in government, the commissioner of SARS. And then, of course, I am here with my team from the department, and I'm grateful to them. Mboneni, Dr. Morf, I'm told now, and Toto, and then Professor Benny, of course, Anderson, representatives of the companies that are going to be winning tonight, distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen. I just want to clarify this thing of the best Director General, because it's been a bit unfair in the sense that the awards actually come with the best department, which means that a director general who directs nothing is useless. So I would have been happier if people were celebrating the people and the staff at the DSI, because they actually do all the work. My job is just to sign things. If it's about a check that must come, that's all I do. But I really want to say that it's really the people that I work with that I'm celebrating, not necessarily myself. But it is a great honor and privilege for me to be talking to you this evening. But let me start off by congratulating the winners of the TT100 Business Awards. I believe this is the 29th anniversary. With time, these awards have become an important measure of the quality of innovation in the private sector. However, I just want to start by reminding you that the story of human innovation is as old as humanity itself. Regardless of the difficulties that human beings have encountered over time, they have always found creative ways of responding to the challenges that they are confronted with. Over the past 100 years, there are a number of inventions that were created, and I just want to remind you of a couple of them. Electric power drill, the pop-up toaster, we take these things for granted. The hair dryer for the women, this is important. Electric kettle, car radio, the smoke detector, electric razor, the list goes on and on. But I do want to talk about our favorite South African innovation. I'm sure you didn't know about this, the breathalyzer. And for those of you who do go to beaches, when you see those concrete slabs that are put on the beach, it's a South African innovation. And you'd be amazed at how it breaks the waves and stops the water from coming to people. All of these interventions and more were produced under some of the most difficult times of the past century. And in spite of this, their inventors still went ahead and produced them. Today, there is no doubt that the single biggest challenge, of course, facing us is the COVID-19 pandemic. The advent of this pandemic is without doubt one of the most daunting challenges of our time. This virus has not only changed our day-to-day habits, it has also altered the ways in which our public and private institutions function and interact. In fact, it has even altered the way in which our world functions, and we can see this today. However, notwithstanding the impact of this virus on our daily lives and the world in which we live in, scientists, researchers, and technology entrepreneurs from across the globe have not stopped to innovate because of COVID. And they have continued to innovate in spite of COVID. And their innovations have been designed to help humanity respond more creatively to what has been referred to as the new normal. So let me just share with you some of these innovations, two of them that we've come across with. In the United States of America, scientists at MIT have designed a robot that uses short wavelength ultraviolet light, known as UVC, to break apart germ DNA. During testing, the robot covered a total of 4,000 square foot warehouse within 30 minutes, providing enough ultraviolet light to neutralize up to 90% of coronavirus particles. The robot has already been used to disinfect the Greater Boston Food Bank, and researchers believe the system could be used in venues ranging from factories and warehouses to schools, offices, supermarkets, and restaurants. As you may have noticed, smartphones are increasingly being used for accessing some of our most important social services. A UK-based company developed a mobile application called DocDot that uses artificial intelligence to enable clinicians to monitor vital signs remotely. This app works by using a light signal processing technology known as remote photoplethysmography, or PPG, through which a smartphone camera records light reflected by blood vessels beneath the skin. Blood volume in microvascular tissue varies in response to respiration, blood pressure, and other changes. The app converts this into measurements that are reportedly 90% as accurate as hospital-grade monitors. Using DocDot, people can look into their smartphone screens and share early indicators of infection. But of course, we are in South Africa, so I also want to talk to you about some exciting and life-changing innovations that are aligned to the theme of tonight, creating transdisciplinary realities. These transdisciplinary innovations would not have been possible without the indefatigable spirit of the bold innovators of our time. And just as importantly, they would not have been possible, we think, if it wasn't for the support of the state. It is for this reason that we recognize as government that one of our key obligations is to provide a conducive climate for individuals, businesses, and other social institutions, companies to thrive. This includes creating an enabling legislative, policy, and regulatory framework for the development of innovative technologies and solutions for pressing societal problems. To this end, we as a Department of Science and Innovation, and please note that we are no longer science technology, and we are taking care and trying to define what we mean by innovation that has been added. And you will see, in fact, on the banner that we have already come up with what is called the tagline. And part of the things that we think we can do is to make sure that certain things are possible. And that is what we'll be spending a lot of time in the next 2 years demonstrating and showcasing within government. So let me share with you a few examples of some of the things that we have done as a department, not alone, of course, with a range of our stakeholders in the public and in the private sector in response to COVID. There are four pillars which I would like to just share with you in short. Analytics and modeling. We all know that at the time, maybe not all of you knew about this, that we had to come up with estimates as to how many people would be infected and when the peak will happen. So we drew on the investments that we had made long, long time ago at the Center for Epidemiological Modeling and Analysis and asked them if they can help us to do this. And if I remember very well at the time, they said two things. One is they said that approximately 700,000 plus minus South Africans will be infected and that we'll get the peak around July, August. The rest is history. But the important thing is that it was using investments that were made long, long time ago in the area of science, technology, and innovation to be able to respond to the pandemic. There's the work that we've been doing on research and innovation. I will share with you just one example of the investment that we made in the early 2000s in the area of genomics. And then we also looked at manufacturing, again, how a multidisciplinary team came together to try and come with a national ventilator project, because as we all know, the challenges of COVID is to make sure that when we have problems breathing, there's enough ventilators. So in fact, I'm told that in one of the meetings that our president was having with a number of other presidents, the president of one country whose tenure is coming to an end, asked our president what is it that he can give to the president of South Africa. So our president said, we will offer you ventilators. This is the President of the United States of America. Because we invested in developing our own locally produced ventilators, a wonderful story of the expertise that we had in South Africa to build the telescope in the Karoo. So the capability of the scientists and engineers that have been trying to look at how you digitize signals, yeah, that have been on the universe over the last 13.5 billion years, very faint signals that you have to then digitize on the antenna and then process them through a locally produced fast computer in Karoo and then try and make sense of what has happened in the universe. They were then the project coordinators working with the Council for Scientific Industrial Research and private companies. Of course, this was essential because the number of ventilators available in the global market had plummeted, and we all know this. And therefore, the South African Radio Astronomy Observatory, working with the Department of Trade, Industry, and Competition, had to work in providing project management, technical guidance, industry engagement, and communication services to the NVP. I think it's over 20,000 of these that have now been completed and they've been delivered. The interesting thing, of course, with this story is that all of a sudden, we've been asked as the Department of Science and Innovation to think about contributing to the reindustrialization of South Africa. And we will, of course, be indicating to the Department of Trade, Industry, and Competition not only what we can do using this example of the National Ventilator Project, but a range of things that we think we can do. The second example that I want to share with you is the KwaZulu-Natal Research and Innovation Sequencing Platform. This investment was made early 2000, so it's a platform that is at UKZN, CAPRISA, and also funded by the Technology Innovation Agency and ourselves as the Department of Science and Innovation, as part of the infrastructure that we thought is important in the country in the Diplomics platform. So what they did is to produce cutting-edge research, support industrial development, and capacitate the next generation of scientists in South Africa. In January, this platform called CRISP, in short, worked with other international groups and developed genomic detective software as an open source tool to help with speed the analysis of the first SARS-CoV-2 genomes. Since then, the software has been used by over 1,000 of scientists all over the world. And this is coming from your own country, KwaZulu-Natal. Don't ask me where I come from. In February, CRISP began with the capacity building and training of 5,000 healthcare workers in order to prepare them for the frontline response. CRISP also organized and ordered critical supply chains for reagents and PPEs, optimized protocols for qPCR diagnostic testing from Thermo Fisher Scientific. In March, CRISP started performing qPCR testing with CAPRISA as part of the Sentinel population cohort to determine when SARS-CoV-2 infections were first seen in South Africa. Don't believe everything that you read on newspapers. Believe what CRISP tells you as to when this happened. It may not be the person from Italy in KZN. In April, our team of infectious disease specialists led an investigation into local nosocomial outbreak early on in the pandemic, which led to science touted as one of the most important and in-depth studies of nosocomial transmissions globally. I can go on and on and on and say that in July, CRISP began assisting the NHLS qPCR testing backlog. You remember there was a time when there was a backlog and you were wondering how the backlog was moved away, and it is them that came to the party to try and assist in this. critical data analysis in real time and key partnership with Nextrain and GISAID allowed for in-country curation of all data. And CRISP was invited by the World Health Organization and Africa Center for Disease Control to join the Genomics Surveillance Network and in Network for Genomic Surveillance in South Africa. So it's a very important platform. Now, where is CRISP going? And I'll tell you where I'm going with this. We plan to expand diagnostic services to help public health beyond KwaZulu-Natal to other provinces. And we are collaborating with Dube Trade Port to set up offices and a high-throughput laboratory at the port. Through this partnership, leverage Dube Trade Port systems to import bulk raw reagents. This will result in more rapid health diagnostics. Now, the reason why I'm telling you this is because most of the companies around here, we think that they should partner with these public institutions to take some of these ideas into the marketplace. So we're inviting you to work with us. Knock on our doors, we are always available, to come and find out what's possible. I'm just sharing with you two examples, and if you, of course, come to us, we'll be able to share with you many. Two more, and then I will conclude. We've also, and Ed knows this very well, have been setting up a National Policy Data Observatory. When COVID started, and I did tell you about the modeling work, a center was set up at the CSIR, and it has been collecting a range of tools on how we can manage the pandemic. And one of the tools that they have developed is something called movement tracking. So when you move with your cell phone, we can see where you're moving from. So they've been doing this, but there are many, many, many other tools that they have developed. So we've partnered then as a Department of Science and Technology with Statistics South Africa and the South African Revenue Services to establish this National Policy Data Observatory. We want to use data to provide scientific analysis to inform government-wide economic recovery, how the pandemic, or how we are likely to get the second resurgence and where it will come from, amongst other things, and also to manage other areas of social change and social psychosupport. Recently, we were looking at the data from this observatory, and it was very, very interesting to see some of the variables in this movement of people in the Eastern Cape. So we're not surprised to see that the hospitals in the Eastern Cape have a problem, because we were able to see that the movements before the pandemic was people, of course, at home and people going to work. And then after the lockdown level, alert level one, people, according to this, they were moving to work and they're moving to parks. So this is where the data tells us. Now, what we don't know, of course, is what is it that they are doing at the parks? And I don't think Nelson Mandela is an area with lots of parks. So what we are now going to do is we are going to overlay this data with other social determinants of what's happening in order to provide government with the reasons why this is the case. So can you imagine an interdisciplinary problem like this that needs to be solved by data analytics, social determinants, as well as the pandemic. So again, another example of transdisciplinary. So in conclusion then, ladies and gentlemen, COVID-19 represents one of the most daunting challenges of our time. But I also believe that the challenges that COVID has presented us also gives us and provides us with excellent opportunities to think things differently. This therefore means that we have it in us to turn the threat that is posed by the pandemic into an opportunity to produce some of the most advanced innovations of our time. I've given you two from abroad, maybe two from South Africa. Inspired by the spirit of your theme, I hope we will embrace the challenge and add fuel to our zeal to innovate. And the companies that are being honored here tonight will also join the national effort, as I've invited you to a few that I shared with you, in ensuring that our country responds more creatively to the challenges of our time. My team knows that one of the most frustrating things for myself is to come back overseas and find myself waiting in a long queue at the airport. I have no reason to do that anymore. The second one is I don't see any reason why I should go to the traffic department to go and renew my license. With the technology today, honestly, I don't have to. So this is some of the things that will be driving within government. It will be easy for all of us here gathered to take comfort in the possibility that future generations are likely to reflect positively on us for the decision we made in the context of our time, which decisions have a direct bearing on their future. Congratulations to all the companies being honored tonight, and thank you for your patience.
Thank you so much, Dr. Majwara, but I will do what you asked, and I shall say to the people and the staff of the Department of Science and Innovation, I'm glad as a fifth industrial revolutionist myself that you have got the watch for our dance between humanity and technology. You asked what it is that is possible, so I'll say anything's possible, because as Audrey Hepburn once said, nothing is impossible. The word itself says, I am possible. So definitely I will say that. But I do want to focus on two things you spoke about that I actually thought were quite critical. The first was around the concept you brought up of human innovation. Prof. Anderson and myself have been chatting quite a lot around this thing about education and formalized education. We have many doctors in the house, myself included, and this is about this Western notion of what education and to be educated means. And I'm in no way saying that we shouldn't be educated or we shouldn't educate, but I am challenging us on the notion that education has to be a Westernized concept, construct, ideology, philosophy, etc. Because what I do want to say is, if you drive along the roads of South Africa and you see the talent of the people out there, you see entrepreneurs that are trying their level best but maybe don't have the resources or the business skill. And one of the other things that I want to speak to before I get to my point around this is this concept of critical thinking. I've really been trying to debate, we debate something like what is critical thinking, and if you define it, you actually kill it. So the thing for me that becomes important is transdisciplinarity, as you spoke to, and that is that when we define concepts and when we look at things like critical thinking and educating people, we should be looking at it from a transdisciplinary perspective. We should be looking at it from multiple spheres and aspects. What do psychologists say, philosophers, etc. So the point I'm really trying to make on these two and bringing back to what you're speaking to is about, and I steal it from one of our doctoral students, and it's this concept of being Africaneers. We really need to embrace the fact, as you spoke to, we've got incredible resources in our country, we've got incredible entrepreneurs and people that are innovators, and we need to stand up and be proud as South Africans and Africans and stop looking to other nations to educate and innovate us, because it is possible to do it all from within and to gather information from outside. Thank you very much for inspiring us with, and I think for many of us, telling us things that were unbelievable, as well as the fact that I love KZN myself. I do appreciate the knowledge and the depth, as I'm sure many of you do as well. But we are here tonight to celebrate with our winners. So we thank Dr. Majwara for being our guest speaker and inspiring us. But now it is time for me to give the house rules as we start to introduce the winners tonight. So we're going to be introducing both the finalists and the winners this evening, and for the 2020 Business Innovation Awards program, and of course the reason that you're all here this evening. So all qualifiers, semi-finalists and finalists, will receive signed certificates after the award ceremony. And then just to note that these will be couriered to each participant. The winner in each category will receive a trophy, beautiful trophy standing over there, during the ceremony, and a signed certificate afterwards at the registration table where you came in. The house rule number two is that I will announce the finalists in each category whilst your company logo will appear on the screen. Thereafter, I will announce the winning company, and the representative from the category of that company would please, if you would please come up when you're announced. And if the person is online, then we will acknowledge the person online. But I think, I think everyone is here this evening, but we will soon see. And then something that's very important to us is also our hospitality. So obviously, we normally do a full sit-down meal for those of you that have been before. Due to the current situation with COVID, as well as just the seating arrangements, etc., you would have had some snacks outside. We will have people walking through and giving you food during the proceedings. And then afterwards, we'd really like you to join us outside behind me to have delicious dessert before you safely go on your way this evening. So without further ado, I would like to call on Jürgen Snell from PwC to please come to the front to present me with the audited results of the finalists and the winners so that I can announce them. Thank you very much. Thank you. So I get to open the envelope. Yay, this is super exciting. Haha, I can see who it is already. Excellent, thank you. Okay. So it gives me great pleasure, as you will see up there, that the first awards are the Management of Technology Awards. I just want to point out that although at times it seems repetitive when we go through the awards, what's really critical to remember is the category that these companies come from, because there are different criteria and requirements coming from different categories. So that is what I will be emphasizing as I announce it, so that it will bring you to the attention of who it is. So I'd like to recall Dr. Dzingai Kasamba as our faculty member in the Management of Technology back to the stage to assist with the awarding of the trophies. So we will stand over here and your photo, etc., will be on the stage. So we are yet to begin. Thank you, Dr. Kasamba. The finalists in the emerging enterprise category for the Management of Technology are PRD Logical Solutions, D22 IT Solutions, BMP Properties, and VNI Consultants. The winner in the Emerging Enterprise category for 2020 Management of Technology is BMP Properties. Archie Rantau, if you could please join us on stage to receive the winning trophy.
Marlowe Burial Society, BMBS is what they call themselves. They are 45 members that are registered shareholders, and BMBS was established since 21 years ago. BMBS demonstrated their distinguished contributions towards sustainability in spite of the increasingly difficult times, and more especially during 2020 pandemic. The 45 members that signed up to the BMBS have since 2020, only this year, received electronic bank statements, and for the first time, virtual meetings were held. They received fewer challenges and received communications from debtors in view of the electronic bank statements. This was the first. They have high retention members. Members are loyal, and the company has grown by word of mouth. BMBS has demonstrated sustainable business performance and embraced both their members and the wider community as the end users. BMBS retained and utilized the skills of their 5-member executive to sustain growth.
Archie Rantau is the representative of BMP Properties. We congratulate you on being a 2020 winner of the Emerging Enterprise category. Congratulations for the Management of Technology. The finalists in the Small Enterprise category, also for the Management of Technology, are Mochocho IT Consulting, Cura Risk Management, Scarab, Stilitso Holdings, and the winner in the small enterprise category for the Management of Technology 2020 is Cura Risk Management Software Pty Limited. Jessica Knight, please join us to receive the award on behalf of Cura Risk Management.
The most impressive company that I adjudicated was in fact in the small category, which was Cura Advisory. Their approach to risk management was really great and innovative. And what I liked a lot about them was their management of the technology and the way in which they were able to commercialize it. It was something that I saw that was really very, very innovative and had a lot of applications, in particularly in what I call the management of risk.
Congratulations, Cura Risk Management. It is now time for us to go to the finalists of the medium enterprise category for the management of technology, and they are Azitron, Axis, iWiz, and Mastech General Trading. The winner in the medium enterprise category for the management of technology 2020 is Access. Terrell Schoon, we welcome you on stage to receive your award.
Within the medium scale enterprises looking at management of technology, our winner there was Access. We had a look at their technology configuration and realized that they are leveraging and utilizing technology as a source of competitive advantage, as they offer solutions to the management of people, the industry within which they operate. And they demonstrated the use and leveraging on technology very well, not only to the internal customer, but also to the end user and their external customers.
Congratulations, Access. Now we get to those large enterprises. So, the finalists in the large enterprise category for the management of technology are IoT.next, Volt Group, Spark ATM Systems, and Van Rennen Steel. The winner in the large enterprise category for the management of technology 2020 is Spark ATM Systems. Russell Berman, please would you join us on stage to receive the winning trophy.
Spark ATM are manufacturers and installers of ATMs, who they supply not only to the financial industry, such as banks, but also to retailers such as Pick and Pays and Macros, etc. They have developed software and support which allows their ATMs to be up and operating 99% of the time. In addition, Spark ATM, instead of importing their ATMs, are now starting to import just the components and to manufacture them locally. In terms of technology, what Spark ATM have done is they have developed a set of applications which they call Spark Lab. It's a suite of applications which is data driven, so it's driven by data analytics, and what it does is identifies hot zones, which essentially means areas where people need ATMs but where there are no ATMs. So some of the applications that they use are, for example, the Spark's Journey, which is an iPad-driven sales tool. So all their sales team have iPads, and they then, all contracts and negotiations and updates are captured on the iPads. So it's taken paper out of the system altogether. So using technology and developing their own apps has put Sparks ATM into a unique position in that not only are they customer driven and customer centric, but they are able to identify new spaces, new customers, and new opportunities.
We congratulate Spark ATM Systems on this wonderful achievement. I feel like a little bit of a cheat that I've got all the results here because I get to sneak a peek. And we thank PwC, as always, for auditing our results. It is really critical to us that everything is done with authenticity. So we thank you as being a partner with us once again. Now we move on to the management of innovation. Dr. Zingai Kasamba, our faculty head for the Management of Innovation, will stay up here to assist in awarding the winning trophies in this category of the Management of Innovation. So we start off with the finalists in the Emerging Enterprise category for the Management of Innovation. They are PRD Logical Solutions, D22 IT Solutions, VNI Consultants, iPads 33 Primary Cooperation, and the winner in the Emerging Enterprise category for the Management of Innovation is D22 IT Solutions. Could Dilesh Kanji please join us on stage to receive the winning
D22
trophy?
D22 IT Solutions. It's an IT company that rescues companies who have challenges with their IT systems on a daily basis. The company goes an extra mile by developing and designing solutions for companies specific to their needs. This business is a winner of this year's Management of Innovation. They are the winners in that they have practical processes and roadmap to actually assist their clients. They design practical solutions for the business with the products they have. This company is indeed a company that will go a long way because they plan to actually increase their market share and develop the business to go further. We are able to see this company in the future.
Congratulations on this remarkable achievement. So we remain in the Management of Innovation, but now we are looking at the finalists in the Small Enterprise category for the Management of Innovation. They are Mochocho IT Consulting, Cura Risk Management Software, Delitzo Holdings, and Scarab. The winner in the Small Enterprise category for the Management of Innovation 2020 is Cura Risk Management Software. Jessica Knight, you are going to be busy, it seems. Please do come up to receive the award.
They offer innovative risk products, and we were so fascinated to realize that they even have products for the COVID-19 pandemic environment in order for them to protect businesses and generate and deliver value. And against that background, we saw it fit for Cura to have an award on the Management of Innovation category. Thank you.
Congratulations to Cura. Dr. Kasamba, you've got that down pat, the elbow thing. Well done, you've mastered it. We now go on to the finalists in the Medium Enterprise category for the Management of Innovation. It gives me great pleasure to introduce our finalists. They are Azitron, iWiz, Access, and Mastech General Trading. The winner in the medium enterprise category for the management of innovation for 2020 is, let me see my timing, Access. Congratulations, Terrell. Please come up and join us.
The Access organization, they were so innovative to take the government requirements and convert them into a system. They converted that into a part of innovation from scratch. Within a period of a month, the organization sat down wherein there are innovative heads and quickly come up with a product or with a system that will then assist organization to keep track of whoever visited the organization, that even the state of the temperature. This kind of innovation will assist the organizations, both the large, small, and micro organizations to combat or to assist the spread of the COVID-19 coronavirus. The good thing of the system is it's eliminate, it simplifies the process, it reduces cost as well as time involved in screening people who visit an organization.
Terrell, quite amazing that you came up with that in a month. So that's very impressive. You and the team, I will go back to what he said. Yes, what Dr. Majora said, you always have assistance. Congratulations to Access. We now move on to the finalists in the large enterprise category for the management of innovation. Gives me pleasure to announce the finalists. They are Van Rennen Steel, The Volt Group, Spark ATM Systems, and IoT.next. The winner in the large enterprise category for the management of innovation for 2020 is The Volt Group. Congratulations. We ask Lance Bohm to please join us on stage to receive the winning trophy.
We had an adjudication of the Volt Group on the large business category. They came up with a very innovative product where you can actually safeguard precious components like cell phones, like watches in malls. They specialize mainly in the fast moving consumer goods. We didn't only look at innovation from a product point of view. When we looked at their processes, how they capture ideas from their employees and various stakeholders around them, they capture ideas, they incubate them, they refine them, they commercialize those ideas, obviously for the benefit of their target market and for the benefit of the whole organization. They are so innovative in the way they do their thing to such an extent that they partner with so many stakeholders in order for them to maximize idea generation and idea harvesting. We had no reservation but to give them that award on management of innovation.
Congratulations, Lance and the Volt Group, on this achievement. Innovation certainly being something critical in times of pandemic, but for always, I think innovation remains a really critical aspect. Thank you, Dr. Kasamba, much appreciated. As you will see, we're now moving on to the management of people. Certainly a critical aspect, the human bridge that connects all of us and connects everything. So it gives me great pleasure to call upon Dr. Dan Ilapa from the Faculty for the Management of People to join me in front to hand over these awards. I hope it feels nice being called Doctor for the first time. You're getting used to it still, Dr. Ilapa. Thank you for joining us in the front to congratulate, and I'm sure you will agree, management of people is a critical aspect. So the finalists in the emerging enterprise category for the management of people are BNI Consultants, D22 IT Solutions, the Venso Group, and BMP Properties. The winner in the Emerging Enterprise category for the Management of People for 2020 is the Venso Group. Congratulations. We call on Zwanga Mabaya to please join us on stage to receive the winning trophy.
The Venso Group is a company that offers services in branding, printing, video production, signage, and events. They call themselves a hub of conceptualization. And in that, with this sort of business they are in, they help conceptualize and assist companies in developing all the services that businesses require. This company is a winner of this year's Management of People. They're a company that cares about people and skills development. It's a company that views skills development as an essential for the youth. It is a company that we are going to see for a long time, in that they plan to increase their market share of the business. And they've also got strategies around how people are able to retain their staff. So it's a business to look out for in the years to come.
Congratulations. And thank you for all you do to bridge the human divide. Dan, you've got to give big smiles. The finalists, now we get to the small enterprise category, also for the Management of People. And I'm indeed delighted to announce the finalists. They are Mick Luck Freight, Mochocho IT Consulting, Cura Risk Management Software, and Delito Holdings. The winner in the small enterprise category for the Management of People for 2020 is, I'm pausing, Mochocho IT Consulting. Congratulations. We call Josla Mochocho up to receive the award.
Mochocho ITC is a small and upcoming ITC company that basically deals in fiber installations or ITC infrastructure installations. Their target marketing, from what they've described and told us, is basically looking at those remote areas that have been previously disadvantaged and try to install all these ITC equipment and ensure that they are connected to the rest of the world. With regards to Management of People, Mochocho has actually tried to incorporate a good retention program and also a good development program for the interns and some of the workers that they work with, especially the technicians. So with regards to ensuring that they retain the technicians that they work with and also continue working with the interns that they enroll, they've come up with a development program that looks at basic training and also training requirements that will empower the technicians and the interns to do their work proficiently and continue to do their work as best as possible. So Mochocho is basically trying to ensure that every available training or training that is relevant to the interns and the technicians, they try to provide that within the resources that they have. So this is to ensure that their people are always upskilled and they're up to date with the skills that are required. This is a great way to ensure that people remain relevant and people are marketable in the market that they belong to. Mochocho has taken the risk to ensure that they empower the people. An empowered employee basically means that the business will grow and they'll be relevant to the communities and the market that they serve. Thank you.
Josla, we congratulate you and Mochocho IT Consulting. I think you really focus on important aspects, certainly being training technicians, the people, rural development and upskilling in IT. Congratulations. The finalists in the medium enterprise category for the Management of People are Azitron, MasTec General Trading, iWiz, and Access. The winner in the medium enterprise category for the Management of People for the year 2020 is Access. Congratulations, Cheryl. Terrell Schoon. Terrell, I'm sure you're getting a little
bit. The next company that I was fortunate to adjudicate was Access, whose business had been disruptive massively, like almost all the businesses, by COVID. And they were able to use their technology, and particularly their management of people in terms of technology, to really deliver an advantage for themselves. It was very much the commercialization of the technology that struck me. So it wasn't just the innovation, but the ability to leverage that for the market and to strengthen their position in terms of the market.
Congratulations to Access and the contributions you make to the management of people. We now move on to the finalists in the large enterprise category, the last area in the management of people. And the finalists are The Volt Group, IoT.next, Van Rennen Steel, and Spark ATM Systems. The winner in the large enterprise category for the management of people for 2020 is Spark ATM Systems. Russell Berman, if you could please come up again to receive the winning trophy.
The organization, the Spark ATM, they have got a family-like culture which drives behind their innovation, their technology. They assist one in the area where one is lacking. As an organization, they rally behind the employees. The foundation of every organization is rooted on its employees, how they keep the relationship with the employees. I encourage them again to keep on doing that, as well how they have said that one of their employees, I'm sure if I'm not mistaken, was a receptionist, how they've upgraded that person to go into the field, which means that they do have a proper people management, which whereby it nurtures everyone, wherever they are in their different level, in their position, so that they can move to the next level, so that they also keep on the entrepreneurial spirit, the innovative spirit to each and everyone within the closet of their organization.
Congratulations to Spark ATM Systems. I think being described as a family is really wonderful, so congratulations on your contribution to people. Thank you very much, Dr. Ilapa. Much appreciated. We now move on to the Management of Systems Awards. I would like to call upon Lebogang Mokoena. He is the head of programs at the Da Vinci Institute to assist in awarding the winning trophies. Thank you, Lebogang. So we start off with the finalists in the Emerging Enterprise category, and this is for awarding of the Management of Systems. The finalists in Emerging are Urban Aquaponics, iPad 33 Primary Corporation, VNI Consultants, and PRD Logical Solutions. The winner in the Emerging Enterprise category for the Management of Systems for 2020 is VNI Consultants. Could Dr. Peter Jatoy please join us on stage to receive the winning trophy?
The organization, they specialized in a system called Edgenomics. It's an online or a cloud-based learning platform. The system is quite different from the traditional or the normal online systems. So on generally, people, they can just come up with an online education platform. However, theirs is quite different in the sense that how you structure, the main issue here is how the content is being structured into the system. And that is the line of demarcation from the traditional online system. So they use collaborators and they are guided by their system on what type of content, how the content is structured into their system.
Congratulations, Dr. Du Toit and the team, on your contribution to the management of systems. We now announce the finalists in the small enterprise category for the management of systems. They are Mochocho IT Consulting, Delizzo Holdings, Meklak Freight, and Cure Risk Management Software. The winner of the small enterprise category for the management of systems for 2020 is Cura Risk Management Software. Jessica Knight, if you could please come up. Between you and Terrell, you are doing some walking.
Within the small business category, looking at management of systems, Cura also scored highly. They demonstrated their capacity to bring together all the key elements within their business by using a systems approach where they synchronize all the components within their business to ensure that they deliver value to the customer from a risk product point of view. So we saw no reservation to award them the Management of Systems Award within the small business category. Thank you.
Congratulations, Cura Risk Management Software. We now move on to the medium enterprise category for the finalists for the management of systems. The finalists are Azitron, iWiz, Access, Mastech General Trading. And the winner in the medium enterprise category for the management of systems for 2020 is Access. Terrell, please come up. Congratulations, Terrell.
Under the TIPS model, the other model that Access product did very well, it's management of system. The Access product, it's a combination of different systems that are using a central database, being able to integrate the existing database or using the central database, it then assists the organization to quickly put the product into the market because, yes, there are different databases. However, it's only being viewed as a single database that then therefore assists the organization on their, on this new product that that's being used to take measurements, to take temperatures as well as checking whether people who are visiting an organization are in compliance, especially on wearing masks, as they were wearing the mask, so as to eliminate a number of standalone systems. Thank you.
Congratulations. I think certainly showing a holistic approach to business when you can score in various categories. So you get to smile with a lot of people tonight, Terrell. We move on to the finalists in the large enterprise category for the management of systems. They are Van Rijn & Steel, Spark ATM Systems, The Vault Group, IoT.next, and the winner in the large enterprise category for the management of systems for 2020 is Spark ATM Systems. Russell Berman, please join us again. Also doing a big walk tonight.
Spark's ATM are unique in the way that they use their systemic thinking. Not only have they excelled in the use of technology, to create a competitive advantage within their space. But they also are people focused and are focused on innovation. So as far as people focus is concerned, they have a smile campaign within their business, which is a campaign designed to focus their whole business on giving personal attention to their clients. As far as their staff is concerned, they are focused on developing their staff. They have an intensive onboarding system. And once staff are onboarded, they have an opportunity to, at any time, innovate their space. As long as their focus is on better performance, better service to customers, they can pretty much do anything to innovate their space and to create that new opportunity. But what is unique about Sparks ATM is that they also give their employees 2 days a month to get involved in their own personal CSI projects. And I think that's quite unique in that it allows the team to develop connections with their customers and also with the society around them.
Congratulations. And thank you very much, Lebogang, for assisting us in the process. We now move on to the Sustainability Awards. I'm sure you will agree sustainability is something that is critical but needs to be authentic. I'd like to call on Dr. Premi Naika, member of the Da Vinci Institute Council, to please assist in awarding the winning trophies in this section. The finalists in the Emerging Enterprise category for excellence in sustainability are VNI Consultants, PRD Logical Solutions, The Venso Group, and iPad 33 Primary Corporation. The winner in the Emerging Enterprise category for Excellence in Sustainability 2020 is PRD Logical Solutions. Portia Mavungu, please come up to receive the award.
We had a great adjudication session with PRD and Emerging Business. We had a look at how they are sustainable as an organization, from an assessment of all their value creation activities within their organization and how that is managed. They've got an innovative product called a wheelchair, which is the first of its kind, as much as we've got so many wheelchairs in the market. But because of the way they are launching by doing researches and finding out what the market needs and how they can satisfy those needs, obviously at a profit, they demonstrated sustainability, and within the category of sustainability, PRD scored very well.
Congratulations, Portia, and wonderful to have you here with us. Sustainability being so critical and certainly in the emerging space. So congratulations, Portia, and your team. The finalists in the Small Enterprise category for Excellence in Sustainability are Deletso Holdings, Kira Risk Management Software, Meklak Freight, and Mochocho IT Consulting. The winner in the Small Enterprise category for Excellence in Sustainability is Kira Risk Management Software. Jessica Knight, please come up.
Kira Risk Management actually provided a very comprehensive framework with regards to the tips that is part of the TT100 Awards. So basically, in terms of sustainability and continued operations, Kiro has done a lot around development of its people. And the one most striking element about their framework is basically supporting people around the work environment and also extracurricular activities. I remember they mentioned that one of their employees employees has moved on to run a gas station, which is something totally outside the risk management space. So this is basically trying to support and empower people that are working for them to pursue their dreams. And I believe that continued support of the talent that you have will continue to grow the people that work for them and also continue to grow the organization as a whole as they continue to grow in the market segment that they are playing in. Thank you very much.
Congratulations to Kira. And I think sustainability certainly is a critical aspect of any business. And we congratulate you on this achievement. We move on to the finalists in the medium enterprise category for excellence in sustainability. And the finalists are Azitron, Access, IWIS, and Mastech General Trading. The winner in the medium enterprise category for excellence in sustainability for 2020 is Azitron. Congratulations. We ask Ansu Sufal to please join us to receive the award.
Azitron achieves sustainable development through a well-developed technology management strategy, which includes collaboration with technology suppliers and large business clients. The company also embraces sustainability through the involvement of community in developing their products and through aggressive skills development strategy for employees and external students.
Congratulations to Azitron and Ansu, who is receiving the award this evening. Congratulations. The last category in sustainability are the finalists in the large enterprise category for excellence in this area. The finalists are Volt Group, Spark ATM Systems, Van Rienen Steel, IoT.next, and the winner in the large enterprise category for excellence in sustainability is Spark ATM Systems. Russell Berman, you'll be doing the walk again.
On the aspect of sustainability, they do use solar panels as well as energy-saving UPS system, whereby one, they don't emit any smoke that will affect our ozone layer. So what the organization has done, especially in this period whereby the country is going through load shedding as well as load reduction, the system, one, it uses a very low amount of energy, or it has got energy saving capabilities, which then therefore assist the grid so that there's no overloading. What is important nowadays is that wherever there's a chance to move away from the grid, it will then alleviate the national grid. So the system, the Spark Lab ATMs, they do have energy saving capability, which is also comes hand for the organization as well as for the country at large. Thank you.
Congratulations. I think it's important to remember that companies often strive in multiple areas, and it is noted at these awards. Thank you so much to Dr. My appreciation. Thank you very much. Sorry about that. I know when you cough in COVID, it's a bit of a problem. So I blocked my mouth there. It is one of my favorite sections next, which is the innovation concepts. For this, I would like to call on certainly a dashing gentleman who is very much in this area of innovation concepts, Mr. Ezra Ndwandwe, for our new venture creation faculty at the Da Vinci Institute. He will be assisting in handing out these awards. Please note, when we announce the category, because of the fact that it is innovation concepts, we announce the concept itself, and of the winner, we announce the company and the concept, because the crux here is about the concept itself. So, the finalists in the emerging enterprise category for innovation concepts are The Parachute, Skaniwe, Smart Baby Bathtub, and the Universal Media Box. The winner in the Emerging Enterprise category for Innovation Concepts for 2020 is The Paratube, PRD Logical Solutions. Portia, we welcome you back on stage and congratulate you.
When it comes to innovation within the Emerging Businesses category, PRD came up with a product called a Paratube, which is a gadget that is put underneath a wheelchair for paraplegics for the comfort of them to use the toilet. This came across as a very innovative product within that space. We looked at it from the whole innovation process point of view, how they gathered ideas, how they screened those ideas, how they have refined those ideas, and now they are doing market testing before they do the full commercialization. They embrace the whole cycle of innovation, and this product is really serving a noble good, and we saw it fit for them to receive this award on innovation from that point of view.
Congratulations, Portia, certainly a noble award. We move on to the finalists in the Small Enterprise category for Innovation Concepts. They are Gideon Inno Textiles, Pack Vault, Cura COVID-19 Workplace Response Tracker, Binary Power System. The winner in the Small Enterprise category for Innovation Concepts 2020 is Pack Vault, the Vault Group. We ask Lance Bohm to please join us on stage to receive the winning trophy.
Pack Vault, it's used for, it's used within the retail industry whereby one can purchase goods online. Then the retailer take all the goods and put them in a cell or in a vault. Then the client will then have to walk in to their nearest shop, whichever shop or retail shop that they've chosen, and go and collect their parcel. So the advantage of this is that it's imminent, especially in this season of or in this period of COVID. It's eliminate mixing with a lot of people. It's natural effect. It is an advantage of so that one has to practice that social distancing. So one has just had to go to the to the shop, and in the shop use technology to open their vault or their pigeonhole and take their good out.
We congratulate you, the Vault Group, on Pack Vaults as the winner of the Innovation Concept in the Small Enterprise category. We now move on to the finalists in the Medium Enterprise category for Best Innovation Concepts. Raptor, Facial Recognition Application, Axis Software, and iWiz. The winner in the Medium Enterprise category for Innovation Concepts 2020 is Azitron Facial Recognition Application. Congratulations. We call on Ansu Supple to join us on stage.
Azitron's concept of face recognition application is very innovative for the use by various sectors, especially for the services that requires authentication of employees of the certain organization. So organization can simply take its database and the faces or pictures of its employees, they put them in the database. When those employees go to households, they can be authenticated by those households that are receiving the services. So one issue of social innovation is the way this technology is made available for free for the use by community. Then various stakeholders can be able to test their application using this technology online.
Ansu, how incredible that you offer this for free to communities who can't pay. And we congratulate you for winning the facial recognition application. Congratulations, Azitron. Our last category in this is the finalists in the large enterprise category for their innovation concepts. They are VRS Wireless Wear Solution, Spark Lab Data Tool, CoVision. And the winner in the large enterprise category for innovation concept 2020 is Van Rennen Steel, VRS Wireless Wear Solution. Ikram Ahmed, if you could please come up and receive the award for Van Rennen Steel.
The third company is a company that I've known for some years, but I hadn't actually interacted with them for a long time. And they were in what I call the heavy metal business and are competing globally and are able to leverage South African innovations in the heavy mining industry for global applications and able to compete with the very big brand names in terms of innovative products. They're not doing long-run manufacture. It's very much a niche manufacturer, and to me that's where South African technology and the management of South African technology is so important, is the ability to do that in specific niches. And again, it was the market acceptance of what VR Steel was doing and their market orientation and market focus that said they were not only able to develop good technology, but more importantly was able to commercialize it for the customer's advantage. And it doesn't matter how great your technology is, if there's not a market for it and you're not able to leverage that market, it's not worthwhile. So it's your commercialization of technology that often lacks in many South African environments. And particularly VR Steel was very good in terms of their commercialization.
Congratulations to VR Steel on this remarkable innovation. Thank you so much to Ezra for assisting us in this category. So now we get to the Director General Award for Overall Excellence. I would like to please call on Mr. Sachaba Motsiawa, for the Chairperson of the Da Vinci Institute Council, alongside Dr. Mboneni Moefe, the Deputy Director General for the Department of Science and Innovation, to please assist me in giving out the Director General Award for Overall Excellence in the Emerging Enterprise and Small Enterprise categories. Thank you. The finalists in the Emerging Enterprise category for Overall Excellence are VNI Consultants, PRD Logical Solutions, D22 IT Solutions, and BNP Properties. The winner in the Emerging Enterprise category for Overall Excellence for 2020 is VNI Consultants, Dr. Peter Du Toit. Congratulations, Dr. Du Toit. Please join us on stage to receive your award. There is not a video for this one, so we get to see their beautiful faces and congratulate them. Congratulations, Dr. Du Toit. The finalists in the Small Enterprise category for Overall Excellence are Mochocho IT Consulting, Cura Risk Management Software, Deletso Holdings, and Meklak Freight. The winner in the small enterprise category for overall excellence for 2020 is Cura Risk Management Software. Jessica Knight, if you could please come up. Certainly important to remember the areas and aspects that people have achieved in the management of technology, innovation, and people and systems, and how holistic it has to be. Congratulations, and thank you to our wonderful hosts, Dr. Moefe and Dr. Motsiawa. Sorry, Mr. Motsiawa, my apologies. Too many doctors in the house, but soon you shall be. All right, now it is certainly that time for the Minister's Award for Overall Excellence. And it gives me great pleasure that the people that will be handing over these awards is firstly the Director General for the Department of Science and Innovation, Dr. Phil Majwara, and the Director of the TT100, Professor Benjamin Anderson. Please come up on stage to hand over the Minister's Award for Overall Excellence. This is in the medium and large enterprise categories. The finalists in the medium enterprise category for overall excellence in 2020 are IWIS, Access, Azitron, and Mastech General Trading. The winner in the medium enterprise category for overall excellence in 2020. Congratulations to you, Terrell, and your team at Access. You have clearly shown the management of technology, innovation, and people and systems across the board in order to receive this award. Congratulations. The finalists in the large enterprise category for overall excellence in 2020 are IoT.next, Funren and Steel, The Vault Group, and Spark ATM Systems. We would like to congratulate the winner for the large enterprise category for overall excellence 2020. The Spark ATM Systems and Russell Berman to receive the award. You have clearly shown your ability in the management of all the spheres to receive this award. Congratulations. And thank you so much, Dr. Majwara and Professor Anderson. So I think Prof. Anderson will tell me that I've achieved this, and Dr. Majwara, in record time. But I think what is critical to remember is we felt it critical to celebrate with you this evening, even though it is during time of pandemic. We wanted to acknowledge you. It is critical to also remember that just because people have won does not mean other people have not achieved. And I think it is really important to remember that to just be a finalist in these categories is really quite remarkable in itself. The reason I say that is because when you look at all these different aspects and the actual metrics that go into this testing, it is actually an exercise in self-reflection. So I started out by saying that this evening is all about transdisciplinary realities, co-creating realities, but most importantly, to never forget your ecosystemic aspects. And I hope that you that have all been here tonight will influence society at the micro, the meso, the exo, and the macro systems, and you will always remember the subsystems at play. It truly warmed my heart to see how many of you are looking in rural communities, you're looking for people that are disadvantaged, either through their own physical disabilities, Portia, and many other aspects. And for me, this was something quite remarkable, to see people that are giving to communities as well. That is critical when I say authentic sustainability, because when you receive an award, for example, for sustainability, sustainability, and you have helped the community in a way that we discussed. I am because we are. That really shows me something about the way that you are taking your subsystems and you are intersecting and dissecting them in your ecosystemic perspective and ways. So I really congratulate not only the winners this evening, but every single person here, and I certainly give you a huge round of applause. I want to say thank you for the participation of each of you. Thank you once again to DSI for your contributions, not only to the evening, but also to education, as you heard this evening on the programs that they're involved in. I really wish you all a safe journey home. I wish you well into the festive season that is upcoming. May you really take the time to rest and rejuvenate as we create a sustainable world in 2021. Thank you very much. That concludes TT 100 2020. Please join us outside for delicious desserts.
Jerusalem, ikayala mi.